So during the Permian, before the dinosaurs evolved, there were some pretty strange animals. And some of these, like those in the early seas, you can only see some relation to modern animals. Like Helicoprion is related to sharks and actually more closely related to the chimeras, but you can only see some of that relation when you look at that animal. But on land, there were different groups evolving too, some of which seem very similar to some modern groups, although not directly those groups just yet, just essentially the predecessors to what would become things like the mammals and the reptiles. And from those, you can actually pick out one that's not really like any of those groups, and that's the animal Moschops, which, I mean, look at it, it's a very strange animal. And Moschops is notable in its bizarre shape, especially its posture where it is higher up in the front of it. Additionally, it has its strange face, which comes from the Greek with its name, meaning calf face, which it makes at least a bit of sense because it does look a bit like a cow. And on the subject of that skull, it is pretty heavily pachycosed, which just means that it's very dense bone. And that means it does preserve pretty well, and we can understand pretty well what it would have looked like. It also had pretty unique teeth, which were relatively long and had a pretty high crown. And that's something else we don't really see that much in the fossil record at this time period during the Permian. And so while Moschops does look kind of silly, it did evolve all those different features for a purpose. And helping us to understand that purpose means we need to put it into a broader geologic context within the Karoo Basin of South Africa, where its fossils come from. And the Karoo Basin is a pretty unique area, or at least it was geologically millions of years ago. From essentially the very late Carboniferous up until the early Jurassic, there was continuous sediment deposition. And what that means is there's a continual set of layers of rock that go from one into another with no breaks within them. To compare this to something like the Grand Canyon, there are multiple breaks called unconformities within the Grand Canyon. And so not having this in the Karoo Basin means we can get a very good understanding of what was happening in the area throughout geologic time. And within the Karoo Basin, there's rock types from many different types of deposition in different environments. And these come from things like glaciers with diamectite, where there's a lot of very small mud that was pushed by the glaciers, but then occasionally larger rocks that were caught by the glaciers. Additionally, you have things like crossbedded sandstones with very large crossbeds, which are indicative of sand dunes. And then finally, you have some things that are more like stream beds that are more related to a more riparian environment that is potentially still somewhat arid, but at least has that river flowing through it. And Moschops specifically comes from the tapanocephalous assemblage zone. And an assemblage zone is essentially an area where there is a specific type of fossil that helps us to understand specifically what layer you are in. And that layer will be pretty consistent throughout very different areas. And so the tapanocephalous area essentially helps us to know this is of this particular time period. And that time period would have been during the late part of the Middle Permian, during the Capitanian. And the Capitanian was occurring about one-third through the overall deposition of the Karoo Basin. In general, during this time period, the world was more arid. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that all the continents were pushed together into Pangaea, and that prevented a lot of moisture from reaching many parts of the globe. However, the Karoo Basin was fortunate in that it did have a shallow sea relatively nearby, as well as the Cape Fold Mountains, which were formed by parts of Antarctica coming into contact with South Africa, which raised large mountains and streams would flow to the north from these mountains. And it's in those streams and around those streams where Moschops made its living. Now, it still wouldn't have been wet all the time. It would have at least had some times of the year where it would have been arid. And that means Moschops may have needed to capitalize on different types of plant life. And there's been a few of these that have been hypothesized, including some very tough plants, the cycads. Cycads look a lot like palm trees, but even the ones that are alive today aren't very closely related to palm trees at all. Instead being much more closely related to spruce and pine trees and gymnosperms. And that's because palm trees and other fruit-bearing trees hadn't even evolved yet. So it was a very different environment as far as the plant life is concerned compared to today and even the Mesozoic, when some of those changes started to take place, especially during the later Mesozoic once the dinosaurs had evolved. But again, this was millions of years before the dinosaurs, and Moschops was among the very first large herbivores to actually start being able to take advantage of some of the plants that had evolved to live on land. But cycads, even today, are very tough and very fibrous, and that could potentially be the reason that Moschops may have evolved those long teeth crowns, essentially to help process some of those more dense, woody, and fibrous plants. Additionally, some of the most nutritious parts of cycads come from their cones, which are even more dense and fibrous. But there are some more nutritious parts within that. So again, potentially Moschops was capitalizing on this food source that was more dense and other animals couldn't necessarily capitalize on because they didn't have the same structures within their teeth. Additionally, Moschops was kind of barrel-bodied, and that means there was a lot of space for a digestive system which could handle more dense plant material. And with that gut system, it would have had to have even more adaptations if Moschops was eating cycads, because cycads today are pretty toxic. We were fortunate that one of our cats only barely nibbled on one and didn't actually eat any of it, and that cat was sick for the rest of the day. And there are cats that do occasionally nibble on plants that have eaten parts of cycads and just don't make it, because cycads are pretty toxic. And so it's really good understanding that Moschops, if it was eating these, would have needed to handle some sort of similar toxin, at least potentially. There's still millions of years between these different groups, essentially of fossil cycads versus modern ones, but there is a chance they would have had a similar toxin. But of course, there were other options that it may have fed on, and not even things like cycads that were quite as dense and fibrous, because it may have been able to feed on some water plants. And it's actually been suggested that Moschops may have been entirely semi-aquatic, so not spending all of its time in the water, but at least spending a lot of time in the water. Kind of like a hippo, where hippos spend a lot of time in the water, but then they leave the water in order to feed, except Moschops would have been spending a more even amount of time doing both of those things. So feeding part of the time in the water and feeding part of the time out of the water, and so not spending as much time in the water as a hippo might. But you can at least understand some of those different behaviors when we look at it in the context of modern animals. The most notable of these is that the neural spines on the vertebra along the back are pretty short in Moschops, and they are pretty short in hippos, with the exception of some of the neural spines that are very near the skull and the shoulders of hippos. But the difference between Moschops and hippos can be seen very easily in their skulls, where hippos have a much larger skull, so need at least some larger neural spines for extra muscle attachments to hold up that skull, whereas Moschops had a smaller skull, so wouldn't necessarily need that same kind of large shoulder projections of the vertebra, where we'd need that extra muscle mass to hold up the head. Additionally, Moschops had a pineal eye, or a third eye as it is sometimes referenced in some modern day types of reptiles. And within those modern reptiles, it is a small hole that you might see in the top, just barely protruding through parts of the skin, and it does go all the way through the skull, and essentially controls a bundle of nerves that are light sensitive, but it can't really see. Thus, sometimes it's called the third eye. With this third eye, reptiles are able to essentially better regulate their circadian rhythms, and essentially when they need to be awake and when they need to be asleep. And it's been suggested that in Moschops, if it was in the water, if it were under the water, that third eye might be better able to help orient the animal to the upward direction. All of this actually led to one of the first reconstructions of Moschops, which was commissioned by the American Museum of Natural History and was done by Mrs. E. Rungius Fulda. And in that image, you can see Moschops feeding next to a stream bed on some low-lying river plants, as opposed to more dense cycads. And as for why it might have needed a high tooth crown if it was feeding on softer, more aquatic plants rather than cycads, it has been suggested that potentially it was just going after mussels and other bivalves that would have been present in these stream systems. So there are multiple ideas for why it might have had these kinds of high tooth crowns and some of the other features that it did evolve. However, a lot of that comes down to essentially needing more specific research and also really helps to highlight how different hypotheses can all be proposed. And what would really help in this case is doing some isotopic analysis of the teeth of Moschops, because there's different isotope balances based on whether a plant is in the water or growing on land. And those then get absorbed into the animal that is eating those. And so if we did those kind of isotopic analyses, we might be able to better understand where Moschops specifically was living. However, there are other behaviors we can find just based on the bones. And one of them actually has a little bit to do with that third pineal eye, as I mentioned earlier, because it's not just a hole that is totally on the top of the skull. Instead, there is a bony boss that surrounds it, essentially protecting that part of the skull. This bony boss, as well as the generally very densely boned skull, has led some researchers to suggest that potentially they were using their skulls for combat within their own species, much like some ceratopsians may have done millions and millions of years later. And this actually has been really hard to test up until recently, which it's important to recognize that Moschops was named in 1911, and it took over 100 years for one of its skulls to get CT scanned so that researchers could understand how the brain works, and more specifically, how the skulls may have lined up against one another. And what they found is that the way the skulls most likely would have lined up would have been a very good way for distributing force against one another. And what that means is, yeah, they probably were using this for combat within their own species. And this can be seen to a somewhat even greater extent in some of the other animals that are pretty closely related to it. As I mentioned earlier, Moschops was found in the Tapanocephalus assemblage zone. And Tapanocephalus was a pretty similar animal, except it had a much larger bony dome over the top of its skull. So it's likely that many animals within this group of closely related animals were doing pretty similar things with intraspecific combat within their own species. And this seems to have been pretty successful for them, because both Moschops and Tapanocephalus were pretty large herbivores that lived alongside one another during the Permian. And they were both pushing about 10 feet long or around 3 meters, and still would have weighed around 1,500 pounds. And as I mentioned, this was before the dinosaurs, which got much larger. And so with these being some of the largest herbivores before the dinosaurs, were these their ancestors? Well, no. And there's a couple of ways we can actually tell that. The easiest way is to look at the two major groups of amniotes. And amniotes are just things that lay, or at least ancestrally, laid a hard-shelled egg. These two groups ancestrally are diapsids with the reptiles and synapsids with the mammals. And basically the difference between them that is the most easy to tell is how many holes there are in the skull for extra muscle attachments. And within the synapsids, you have just one extra hole, but within the diapsids, you have two. And within animals like Moschops, you only have one of these sets of holes, which means that it is much more closely related to you and me than it is to any reptile, despite the fact that it did have some reptile-like characteristics. And I say this because it was still probably at least somewhat cold-blooded. However, you can actually start seeing some of the features that would become more mammal-like starting to show up in animals like Moschops. And Moschops actually evolved many of these entirely independently from the lineage that would lead to the mammals, but it is at least a showing of some of the evolutionary pathways that may have been taking place already starting within some of the more basal synapses, rather than the ones that did lead to the mammals. Some of these features include a specialized elbow joint, which would have helped them to hold themselves more upright, more similar to a modern-day mammal posture, rather than a more sprawling lizard-like posture like some of the earlier synapsids, like Dimetrodon and Dilophosaurus, which had a much more sprawling posture, although could still potentially high-walk. Additionally, many of the other synapsids had a very specific type of tooth joint that's very different from ours. They had an ankylosed tooth joint, which means the tooth itself is fused directly to the bone. We don't have that. We have a gomphosis type tooth joint, which means the tooth sits more loosely in the joint and there are ligaments running across the tooth which help to hold the tooth in place in that socket. So it's a much different type of joint. And this kind of flexibility in the joint helped the mammals eventually become much more successful because there was more options and more ability for the teeth to come into more direct contact for chewing, especially with things like our molars, which need to be in that kind of direct contact. And the same thing may have been true with animals like Moschops, because while not directly related to mammals, it did also evolve this kind of gomphosis-type joint. And what does that gomphosis in Moschops mean? Maybe it was eating some of those cycads and more dense fibrous plant materials, and maybe that gomphosis helped the teeth be more flexible so that it could come into direct contact with one another when it was trying to chew. So for the question, what the hell was Moschops? Well, it was a synapsid, meaning it's closer related again to any mammal than it is to any reptile, despite the fact that it's very bizarre for any mammal, at least when we compare them to mammals today. But within Moschops, we can see some of the evolutionary pathways that led to the mammal success. And while there was an extinction event in the middle of the Permian that did cause Moschops and its relatives to die out and other herbivores to take their place, which then died out and were eventually overtaken by the dinosaurs, eventually the mammals did get there, with many of the same adaptations that Moschops had. So if history went differently and certain extinction events just didn't happen, maybe we'd still have large herbivores more similar to Moschops running around the world today than we have things like deer. But Moschops is a great example of how you can have many of the same adaptations that become successful later on, but if they're not working out in that moment, the animal might still die out. So while Moschops was here for a good time and its group was very successful, it certainly wasn't here for a long time.